Great, thank you. Our next presentation, we're in the Module 2 section, Smoke Alarm Installation and Maintenance. What role does the human behavior play? Will be given to us by Phil Shaman from TriVision Data. Phil has researched best practices in fire prevention nationally and internationally for 38 years. Phil was an associate administrator for the U.S. Fire Administration for 5 years before founding TriData 33 years ago. Phil started in the U.S. Fire Administration's Fire in the United States series. He co-authored Overcoming Barriers to Public Fire Education, Proving Fire Public Education Works, Researching the Hard to Reach, and Global Concepts in Residential Fire Safety. He holds advanced engineering degrees from Stanford and Columbia. He is a founding member of the steering committee of Vision 2020, and he is frustrated that the U.S. does a lot of pilot prevention projects, but too few community-wide scales, so he has taken up competitive ballroom dancing and is a huge fan of Dancing with the Stars, as are all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, Phil will have 10 minutes, then he'll be followed by Zach, and then by Elise. Then we will open it up to discussion.
I just got a 5-minute warning. Okay. I do competitive ballroom nationally, relieve tensions. All right, I have two talks to give you, each 5 minutes, so I'm gonna go at New York speed. Hope everybody keeps up. The AFG program has done a fantastic job of getting results, and not everybody knows about them, so I wanna summarize some of the things we've learned. The first thing I'm talking about is the results of home visit programs in 29 communities that were funded through grants to the Washington State Association of Fire Marshals and to IFE, both sort of under guidance of Vision 2020. Over a 5-year period, about 29 communities got visited. A number of them have representatives here, Dallas, Tucson, Vancouver, Philadelphia, and Cleveland that I know of. They were asked to go to high-risk homes that they could define either on the basis of fire incidents or the type of home, like mobile homes, or known socioeconomic characteristics of the homes. The idea was to get to the high-risk homes, get firefighters or members of the community or both to make the visits, check the smoke alarms, and install smoke alarms if what they found were not sufficient. And the grant primarily was buying alarms to do the installations. We think there's some very important results that came out of this. 21,000 homes were visited, of which 14,000 got entered. Main reason for not entering homes was nobody was home. If you had a program that scheduled visits, tended to get 100% home. If you did canvassing, some people were not home. In the homes that got entered, there were 33,000 people, and 67% of those homes had a high-risk demographic factor, elderly, children under 5, smokers, people with disabilities. So by and large, we think they did get to homes that were high risk, and based on their smoke alarm situation, it was another indication they got to the high risk homes. So what do they find? Situation found. Homes with no working smoke alarms, the grand average over the 5 years was 35%. Over a third of the homes, these are the high risk homes, had no working smoke alarm. 26% of the homes smoke alarms were not working. Okay, so a quarter of the alarms were not working. And this is now people going, the firefighters or other people who were trained went in and tested them. So this was not hearsay, this is hard data. People were asked if they had an escape plan, and 39% admitted they didn't. I suspect the real number is much higher, but to check their honesty, we asked them, okay, you have an escape plan, where do you meet? And so we had statistics that about two-thirds of them did know where they were gonna meet. So that was a little bit of a verification. Once they went in and inspected, if they were not sufficient smoke alarms, they installed them. 35,000 alarms got installed for which we have data. There was actually more than that. The average number needed to be installed per home was 2.6. So between 2 and 3 alarms were installed per home. Most of the homes, 88%, were given instruction on how to maintain the smoke alarms. Two-thirds were given written information. And we have that data as a baseline now on 30,000, on 20,000 households, where we know not only what their smoke alarm situation was, but also what public education they got one-on-one. And that's a baseline that can be used in future years' evaluations. So what are the results of these visits? At the end, 96% of the homes had working smoke alarms. There was an average of 3.8, almost 4 working alarms per home, and about 87% of the homes met code. Why those weren't 100% with working alarms and 100% meeting codes generally were that the home kicked the firefighters out after a certain point and said, we don't want any more. You're making too much noise, or we just don't want to be bothered. We'll take care of it ourselves. But the vast majority of people welcomed them, loved having them in, and accepted the alarms. Going forward, I think we have to institutionalize the concept of home visits in the fire service, not just do pilot projects. We have proven in 29 communities, large and small, through these grants, and a much larger number that we know of just from hearsay or people who have come approached Vision 2020, that these home visits work. And from the international research I did, we found in every community in Britain, in Canada, in Australia, that reached all of their homes or almost all of their homes over a 5-year period, they had a 50 to 60% reduction in fire deaths. And that was 50 to 60% reduction from a lower level than we are. So it wasn't cream skimming, it was working on harder and harder to get to the bedrock. So we know this was the best practice I found on a 3-year study going all over the world with CDC. Somebody had to do it. Finding the best practices. So this has already been proven internationally. We need to evaluate the results in the United States with reported fires, with casualties. We have the baseline to do this now. We need to convince firefighters to help with home safety visits. You can't do this with prevention staff alone. There's just not enough prevention staff to make enough home visits, even to the high-risk homes. So this is an agenda for going forward that we can talk about. Okay, so we know we have proven that we can go to homes. We've proven that we can do it a variety of ways. 2 firefighters, 1 firefighter, 1 member of a community organization like a Hispanic interest group, or even totally with members from the community. We have a wide variety of methodologies that work. And all of them had about the same findings and about the same results. Okay, second thing I wanted to talk to you about was the results of a national survey on firefighter attitudes toward prevention. We want the fire service to participate, so what do they think about prevention? We did a survey that wound up having 600 firefighters responding from 173 communities in 42 states, so it was a pretty darn good national sample with all sizes of departments, some volunteers, mostly career. 87% of the respondents were in operations, which is what we had asked for. We wanted line firefighters, was aimed for. We could not get a random survey with the limited funds and ability we had, so this questionnaire was online, it was short, and it was advertised by IFE and the Washington State Association of Fire Marshals, and VFC ran an article and kindly helped promote it and others. So part of the sample was self-selected, so it's a little bit biased toward prevention interested people, and part was not self-selected. The chief told 50 firefighters, fill it out. They were asked to volunteer. The chief selected who would fill them out. The chief self-selected for the department. Okay. So, well, as I'll say later, we'd like to get a more random version of this, but we still did get 600 firefighters, most of whom aligned firefighters not assigned to prevention, to get their attitudes. And they were positively shocking in a positive way. We asked them, had they participated in inspections, and the vast majority of them said yes. 88% said they had participated in inspections. 80% businesses, 60% schools. But shockingly, 75% of these 600 firefighters said they had gone to a single family home. And my reaction to that was, what? You really, really? And from other comments on the thing, we think that they were telling the truth. Now, these were a small number. They went to a small number of homes. There were specialized circumstances, but they did break the ice. 97% said they participated in public education, mostly in schools. Most firefighters wind up being asked to traipse to their local schools during their career. Many did education during station visits, but 29% said they had done public education in single-family dwellings. So that was shocking. But one of the takeaways from this is the ice has been broken for firefighters doing home visits. There are lots of firefighters out there who have done home visits. We asked them about their attitude toward prevention in general. 98% said that they thought prevention was important for their department to do. And 58% of them said the department should do more prevention. 39% thought it was about the right level, and only 2% said do less. Now again, this was probably a biased sample, but it still was national and it still was 600 firefighters. So we asked them what their attitudes would be toward home safety visits. And 2/3 of them said the department should do home safety visits. And 77% said they were willing to do home safety visits themselves. And I found that an anomaly. I would have thought more would say they'd be willing to do it than that their department should do it. But still, the majority of these firefighters said they'd be willing to do home visits. So then we asked two very important follow-up questions. One was, why do you think you want to do home visits, or why not? And the main reason they said they were willing to do home visits was not from what you might expect. The main reason they thought was good public relations and increasing the value of firefighters to the community, not that it would save lives. So that's very important to know. One of the appeals to firefighters is you want to get good PR. You want the community to feel to support you. And that's important to know when you're approaching them. 80% thought that it would reduce civilian casualties. And the other surprising thing that popped up high was that 71% thought it would reduce injuries to firefighters. And I thought of Vina Drennan and her husband who lost his life, a New York City firefighter, and who was proselytized for prevention programs on the basis that they'll save firefighter lives. And certainly the foundation that Ron Smucki heads has encouraged that concept also. You're going to save firefighter lives, not just civilian lives. Now, why were they not willing to do visits? The top reason was too much to do already, and particularly for volunteers were saying this. Now, that says something about choosing priorities in the fire department, in the fire service. Okay, what should your priorities be? I got too much to do. I already got to shine the engines every day. You know, are there some tasks that you could consider lower priority than others? Can you reassign manpower from doing things that are less important than others? And departments around the world are reassigning, are rethinking what's more important to do. The second biggest reason that came out for not doing home visits was fear of liability. And they thought you might get sued if something went wrong. And we know that that's a false bugaboo, and we need more information. And Jeff from the Paradigm Foundation may help us answer that question that we have ammunition to say, no, it's really not that much liability at risk, maybe none at all. Another top reason was not trained to do it, and that we can certainly do something about. Vision 2020 is putting out pamphlets on just exactly how you do these home visits. And another one that surprised me was 11% said they were concerned about personal safety. You visit the home and somebody's gonna bop you in the head. Now, that tends not to happen, but these are things that if we know about, we can address. Some of the written in comments were important. There were two veins that showed up a lot. One was that people's privacy should be respected, and it's a step too far for government to go in. And a lot of people a lot of firefighters don't get it that the citizen has to let you in the home, that you're not forcing your way into the home. So if you tell them we're only going into the homes where you're welcome, that can shoot that down. So going forward, I think we need broader data. We need a larger, more random sample. I would like to see the analysis done by state, by various population groups, by volunteer firefighters versus others as to reasons of why they can or can't do home visits. I think we can develop strategies to overcome the firefighter objections, explaining households have to allow entry in order to go in, showing that the risk of liability is low, teaching how to do visits, and most important, getting the fire service leadership to think strategically about their workday priorities over the weekend, over the year. There are fire departments around the world now that are finding over a 4 or 5 year period, they're able to visit almost all of the households in the community. They don't go out and visit all at once, and they try to go to the higher risk areas at first. But over a 4 or 5 year period, a lot of places have shown that it's feasible to do this. And the stunning result is if you do it, you get a 50 to 60% reduction of fire deaths. And why? Because you're installing those smoke alarms and you're addressing those statistics that we saw this morning about not having smoke alarms there. So that's a lot of food for thought. You can see some more of the details in the paper that was given, and we have more detailed papers backing those up too. So thank you.
And again, when we get to discussion, Phil and Zach and Elise will join me up here, so you'll be able to ask Phil questions. I'm sure you've got many. That was a lot of information. Next up will be Zach. Now I'm going to butcher this. I was practicing it all the day. But Boileau?
Close enough.
Dang. And I took French in college, so that's terrible. Zach brings a mixture of communications experience to his research role at Statler Mitchell, migrating from a journalism major to public relations professional before landing a communications research. His experience affords him the ability to study an issue or strategy from all angles and propose a reasoned solution, a skill that he demonstrated working with Vision 2020 to develop, test, and revise smoke alarm safety and kitchen fire safety messaging to use nationwide, which include dozens of interviews, several focus groups, and a survey. Zach holds a bachelor's degree in journalism from Ohio University and a master's degree in communications from American University. Ladies and gentlemen, Zach.
Thanks, Bobby. And thanks, everybody, for having me here. He's going to get my slide up. I am not an expert on fire the way everybody else is here today, so I want to put that out there. I don't want you to hold it against me. So we've worked with Vision 2024. We're at Salter Mitchell. We've worked with Vision 2024 a few years now, doing a lot of research around messaging as it pertains to smoke alarms, as it pertains to fire safety generally, as it pertains to kitchen safety. So today I want to walk you guys through some of the research we've done as it relates to the smoke alarm specifically. So it's been an iterative process. It's been a year-long process, I think, that took place between the fall of 2012 and the fall of 2013. I say that it's iterative because we went through a lot of different phases, ultimately to try to come out at the end with some messaging that we thought would resonate with consumers, specifically at-risk communities, regarding smoke alarms and smoke alarm safety. So we started with trying to understand their perceptions and their behaviors as they related to smoke alarms and the safety, and then leveraging those findings into strategies and framing positions that we could take for communications, and then turning that into taglines and then testing those taglines. So it is very iterative, and it went through quite a process. I should also really quickly note that it was a qualitative process. You know, when we do a lot of our communication testing at Salter Mitchell, it is very qualitative. It's to get that sort of larger feedback that people have. So you're not going to hear me spout statistics at you when we go through this. It boils down to some focus groups that we started with to try to understand the behaviors and the barriers, and then a series of intercept at door-to-door intercept interviews in people's homes in neighborhoods that were defined as at risk or described as at risk. And then finally, we did a disaster check with some fire department professionals through a brief online survey. It was absolutely not random, but it did help us sort of make sure that we were on the right track. So I want to start with talking about the behaviors and the barriers. At Salter Mitchell, I'm really glad that you brought up the behavior economics story at the very beginning of this, because that's sort of how we approach a lot of this stuff. We sort of filter every behavior that we look at through 12 common behavioral determinants. So those could be things related to norms, or those are things that we talk about the rewards and the risks that are involved in something. It's also sometimes as easy as just what the efficacy of the perceived behavior is. Ultimately, we sort of bucket them into three different sort of categories, consequences, ability, and expectations. But the way we talk about it is we say, is this fun? Is this easy? And is this popular? And if we can make them easy, popular, and fun, then we have a lot more chance at making the behavior a success. So when we talk about the behavior of smoke alarms, it really, in terms of making sure that people have working smoke alarms, it sort of boils down to three different behaviors, and that's owning the alarm in the first place, that's testing the alarm, and that's maintaining it. So also not, not disabling it in any sort of way. The thing is, though, when we talk about all three of those things in a messaging sense, they carry different challenges, and they require different sort of calls to action. So we try to boil that down into, when it comes to the messaging, we're trying to boil that down into have a working smoke alarm. Like, that's the behavior that we're aiming for. But we also need to understand what those three components are and the barriers that exist for each of them first. So when we talk about owning an alarm, the people that we talk to, I think a lot of this stuff is going to make common sense to most of you, and you've definitely heard a lot of it before. But do people own an alarm? Most people claim that they own an alarm. I mean, we've heard that already today. We're going to hear it more, I'm sure. They claim that they own an alarm, at least one alarm. Some people claim that they own more than one. However, when we were doing these intercepts and we asked people to test that alarm, it doesn't necessarily mean that that alarm is working. And it was a surprise to many of the people that we were actually talked to in their homes that this alarm that they thought was there and working wasn't working at all. So what are the sort of perceived barriers of why I wouldn't own an alarm? Lorraine mentioned this earlier. There's a perceived lack of risk. Like, people, we talked about how the risk of fire death has dropped. I think the number was 50% since smoke alarms became much more common. I don't think that these things are lost among people. They recognize that that smoke alarms are a common thing, that are the normal thing to have and to do. And so many of the people we talked to would say that. Well, what risk am I at having a fire? It was only the people who had experienced a fire, who had somebody in their family experience a fire, that ever really recognized the risk. Everybody else just sort of sees it as, really, my smoke alarm is not a savior for me. It's a nuisance. It goes off when I cook. It's too close to my stove. The chirping is obnoxious in the middle of the night. There's hardwire problems. So part of it is a framing issue, right? Like, they don't see it as any sort of savior or any sort of real protection. They see it as a nuisance above all else, a nuisance that they are supposed to have, a nuisance that they know they should have, but a nuisance nonetheless. And so it's a lot less likely to pay. You're a lot less likely to pay attention to that if you're not seeing the value in it. So then we talk about testing alarms. So most people told us that they push the button, even though we know that that's not true. Really, how most people test their alarm is by setting it off with a smoky pan of bacon or however they're cooking in the kitchen. That's how they test their alarms. And many people would freely admit that. Of those who said that they tested, they claim to have some sort of schedule. I do it during daylight savings in the fall and in the spring. But really, most people, when you press them on what is your schedule, they wouldn't really have one. So we talk about what are the barriers to testing your alarm. Sometimes it's physically out of reach. I believe you said you had 9-foot ceilings. It's hard to get to. And especially if you're an older person or a disabled person, they're not easy to get to sometimes. Sometimes renters see that they are out of their hands. Their landlord has said, I will take care of this. Or the landlord has explicitly said, you're not to take care of this. So they don't see any sort of control in the matter. There's also somewhat of a lack of a visual cue. It's up on the ceiling. It's sort of out of the way. And so when it's not in your face every day, you forget to test it. Again, there's that perceived lack of risk. There's also, we were talking earlier about all the different codes and recommendations, and we were trying to figure out what the messaging would be. We say, okay, so what do we want to tell them to test it in the fall, in the spring, and daylight savings? He's like, well, no, that's not common. That's not frequent enough. They need to test it every month. These different sort of recommendations and different sort of codes and classifications, they confuse people, and they often lead to some skepticism on their part. You tell somebody that they need to test their smoke alarm once a month, they're going to say you're crazy and that they don't need to do that, and that's way too frequent.
Or weekly.
Or weekly. So disabling alarms. So most people that we talk to, and we keep in mind, we're going to people's homes and, you know, intercepting them there, they would not really admit to disabling their alarm. We know that's not true, right? But for the people who would admit to disabling an alarm, they'd say that the main reason they would do it is when the chirp would go off, and they knew that they needed to change the battery and that it was time to move on to a new battery. But they wouldn't really admit to doing it during cooking. They said they would fan the smoke away from the alarm, open windows, that sort of thing. But really, when it came to like putting the alarm back up after you had disabled it, after you'd taken the batteries out, or however you did it, it was a visual cue. It was the fact that they had taken the alarm down and now it was sitting on their counter and was looking at them. Or it was dangling from the ceiling and they could see it as they walked into the room. That's what reminded them to fix it and fix it back into the place it was supposed to be. So why? Why do people disable their alarms? It's because it's loud and it's annoying. And it bothers their pets, and it wakes their babies, and it's too close to the kitchen, and whoa, already, woof. Okay, we're gonna move along here. So, effective messaging. There's a lot of things competing for people's time, right? This is a short list of all the things that people have to think about, all the risks that exist out there. So we need to think, are we trying to sell them more risk, or are we trying to sell them something else? So what we did was we looked at the fact that we don't want to sell them an alarm. We want to sell them something else. So we created this messaging frame that the problem with smoke alarms is that there's no immediate reward for testing it or making sure that it works, right? There's a long-term reward is that you're safe. That's great. But that doesn't affect people in the moment. So we need to tie an immediate reward with some new information that they can actually use and act upon and create this effective message. So there's some different elements that work. Emotional appeals work. Emotional appeals work as long as we're not scaring people. You know, if we're able to position the smoke alarms in an emotional way, it changes the frame. And you know, appeals to control work, appeals to their roles as protectors and providers. How-to information, as I mentioned, vivid language. So I want to get to some of the things, some of the messages that we're sort of moving forward with. The first one is where there is love, there are smoke alarms. This message resonated with people pretty well, really well. And more importantly, it got them to think about their smoke alarms in a different way. It got them to stop thinking that their alarm was just a nuisance, but that was a way for them to show their family that they loved them, show their family that they cared about them, and do that in an immediate sense. It lacks some catchiness, that's true. It doesn't really fit very well with images of smoke alarms. But I would again argue that that is part of the disruption that needs to take place in order to get people to think about this in a different way. We also have gone through with the smoke alarms, a sound you can live with. This is an older message, I think. And it's less emotional, but it gets people to think about the live part of it and moves it a little bit further away to say, like, the nuisance is okay. So we tested with fire professionals, and most of them really liked the idea that we were framing this in a new way, in a new direction, an emotional way that would get people hooked in a different sense of rather than just being scared or rather than thinking that it's a chore that they have to get done. They wanted to avoid anything risky. One of the messages we tested, which I kind of liked, was give a beep, smoke alarm, show you care. They didn't really care for that. They thought it was a little risque, and so, you know, we end up, yeah. They also expressed a need for multiple messages, right? When we first approached this, we were trying to find one common tagline that we could apply to smoke alarm safety, something like fire is everyone's fight. The truth is that it doesn't really work for smoke alarms. There's too many different things we're trying to get people to work on, and we tried for a long time to find that single message and never really landed on it. And I don't think it's there. The last thing is that they wanted to be able to customize the messaging to their local populations. And that's something that we've actually started moving into a next phase with Vision 2020 on, and something that we call a materials generator. This is a thing that we have at Salter Mitchell that we've created for several clients. What it is a way to take a common brand and disseminate it through different branches. So for this instance, it would be local fire departments. that can use the common messaging, use the common look, common elements that create the brand, and then, you know, apply it to their local population. You know, they have some certain restrictions that they have to operate in, and then they're able to make it local. And that's where we are headed now. Thank you.
Thank you, Zach. That was excellent. Next up is Elise Omaki, and Elise is a research associate with the Johns Hopkins Center for Injury Research and Policy. Elise has a master's degree in epidemiology from the Johns Hopkins School of Public Health. She's the project director for multiple research studies that aim to connect high-risk families to fire safety resources such as smoke alarms. Elise?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Can everyone hear me okay in the back? Yep. All right, thank you. So my job today is to summarize some of the public health literature around community intervention trials that have been done around smoke alarm installation, maintenance, and behaviors. And I have five different points to make, mostly based off of data from our Baltimore studies, but I also want to share some work that has been done in Dallas and Iowa. And I know Dr. Istry is here, who was involved in that work, and also Dr. Yang from the team that did work in Iowa. So some of the approaches that we've talked about today have been door-to-door canvassing, and we have the CDC SAFE program, which recommends working with community coordinators and local fire departments to go door-to-door canvassing to install smoke alarms. They recommend having lithium battery smoke alarms with a hush feature. In Baltimore, we did a variation of that program where we randomized half of our neighborhoods to receive pre-promotion from a community health worker. And so that community health worker went about 3 or 4 days before the fire department to let them know that the fire department was coming. And we found that those homes who had had that heads-up notice were more likely to let the fire department into their home on the day than the fire department was there. So 75% of those who had received the pre-promotion let the fire department into their homes versus 62% of those who hadn't had that heads-up notice. Those who had had the pre-promotion also were more likely to be left with a working smoke alarm on every level, which was the standard that we were using here in Baltimore. So we used that data from our Baltimore study to look at the cost-effectiveness of this program. We applied whatever available epidemiologic data we had, as well as a number of factors related to determining if the program was cost-effective. So these are things like the probability of a resident being home on the day that the fire department comes around, the probability that the fire department is allowed inside the home to install smoke alarms, the probability that a home needs a smoke alarm, the probability of having a fire in that home now that you've had a smoke alarm installed, and then the probability of having a fatality in that fire. And so we applied all of that to a hypothetical population of 10,000 homes. And what we see is that based on our data in Baltimore, we were able to increase the number of homes that had no working smoke alarm by 10%. So, and I'm going to come back to that point in just a second. And when you apply all these different factors, what we came out with was that it was about $28,000 per death averted. So this analysis was based on having no working smoke alarm to having one working smoke alarm. And I think this is something we touched on a little bit in the data module last time about how many smoke alarms is enough. And one of the things that we were limited by was that the statistic about whether how protective smoke alarms are is based on having no smoke alarm to having any smoke alarm. And so we had a number of houses that had, say, one smoke alarm, and then we gave them two more. but we don't have information about, you know, would that scenario reduce your risk of death? And if that was the case, then we would expect to see this cost per death averted to come down. So the other part of this research is we talked to about 600 residents about their smoke alarms. This was 600 households that we talked to. And we did a survey of them. We sat down, and one of our questions was, do you have a working smoke alarm on every level? And everyone replied, not everyone, but a lot of people said, yes, I do have a working smoke alarm on every level. And then at the end of the survey, we said, okay, now we're going to go test your smoke alarms. And we went around, and we tested their smoke alarms. And when we went around and tested it, only 41% of people had a working smoke alarm. So what we realize is there's this disconnect between what people are reporting and what they actually have, and that's been discussed a little bit. So we called up those people who had said, yes, I have a working smoke alarm on every level, but they didn't actually have one. And we said, why did you tell us that? And what they said is about half of those people had assumed that all the smoke alarms were working because it hadn't beeped, it hadn't gone off, and so they just hadn't really tested or known a lot about their alarms and assumed that they were working. Another 22% thought their homes were safe, despite not having a smoke alarm on every level. So they could see one on their main floor, but hadn't really thought about smoke alarms on their other floors. As part of that survey, we also asked people about their knowledge and beliefs of smoke alarms. Only 57% of residents were able to answer 9 knowledge questions correctly about smoke alarms and home fire safety. So this included things like having a fire escape plan, the consequences of house fires, how many smoke alarms should be used. In addition, on average, residents thought it was not very likely that they would be experience a house fire, but they did believe that house fires were a serious problem and they had severe consequences. Residents who reported feeling confident that they were able to maintain their smoke alarms were twice as likely to have working smoke alarms observed in their home. So this was, again, when we went around and tested them, those people who said they were really confident in being able to maintain them were more likely to have them. So the last little bit of data I have is around lithium battery alarms. And so there's been a couple follow-up studies on these in terms of how long they last and how easy they are to maintain for the resident. So analysis of the CDC SAFE program found that after 8 to 10 years, only 33% were still functional. 37% were missing, so those alarms had not been in the house when they went back to look for them. And then 30% were non-functional because either the battery had died or been removed, or the alarm itself had been malfunctioned. Another evaluation was done 6 to 10 years after the installation. And they found that only 62%, they showed that 62% of those alarms were non-functional, again, due to missing or disconnected batteries or some malfunction of the battery. That study also showed this really decline in the number of homes that had at least one working smoke alarm after the program. So after 2 years, you could see that 91% of those homes had a working smoke alarm from the program, and then by 10 years, it was only 19%. So a third study looked at comparing lithium battery alarms to the 9-volt battery alarms and found that after 3.5 years, that lithium battery alarms were more likely to be up and working than those 9-volt battery alarms. This was especially true for alarms that had not had a nuisance alarm in the meantime, so that the nuisance alarms were more likely to have been disconnected in some way. In Baltimore, we did a 6-month follow-up of our smoke alarm data, and after 6 months, 90% of our lithium battery alarms were still up and working. About 100 of the alarms had been taken down. We couldn't find them in the homes. And then we found only 37 non-working alarms in the home at 6 months. Most people said they didn't know why the alarm wasn't working at that point, but some people, when we asked them, why is this alarm not working, some people said they took it down because it was beeping or because it had gone off while they were cooking. So I will leave it at that for our discussion. Okay.
I'd ask Phil and Zach to come back up too, also, if you don't mind. Thank you very much. We're now going to discuss what gaps were just identified. Microphones. Oh, there they are. Sorry. They probably would have bit me.
Microphone.
Thank you, Eric. Thank you. And also, if you could please use the microphones, because that way that will get picked up on the recording. So if you could just wait for the mic, raise your hands, and the mic will come over. Eric's got them both. Yeah. So now we're going to discuss what gaps we've identified or we perhaps didn't identify in human behavior, and then we'll talk about identifying some of those gaps, and our panelists are right here. Over here? We got a mic coming your way.
So, Zach, I think this is for you, but everybody else too. Do you see, I experience that in our fire prevention world that there are lots of conflicting messages about smoke alarms. What the code says, what the packaging information says about the manufacturer, what USFA and NFPA and Oklahoma says. Tell us how that impacts our consumer.
It confuses them. I mean, that's sort of simple, right? Like, it confuses them. It makes them less likely to act. You know, they creates questions in their mind, and sometimes those questions can lead to skepticism. So, you know, you don't know who to trust, what to trust. So, you know, it's one of the reasons why we were trying to boil it down to make sure you have a working smoke alarm. And you know, to the degree that we're able to support that with messaging and interventions that simplify things for people, the more success you're likely to have.
I want to follow on that message. Did I understand from your presentation that it was the fire departments who said, oh, we need more than one message?
Yes.
Maybe they're not the best judges of that. I think one of our gaps is what one single message should we focus on?
Yeah, no, I definitely understand that. And I think that, and that's certainly the, that was a lot of the drive behind the research that we were conducting. It's one of the reasons that this project lasted a year, to be honest with you. You know, we started in the beginning really trying to narrow down on what a single tagline could be for smoke alarm safety. But what we found was that the behaviors that are involved with that, there's multiple ones, and there's multiple directions and multiple codes and all this stuff that need to be considered as you start to develop these messages. And it's one of the reasons why we ended up sort of narrowing down into something that was much more overarching and focusing on that immediate need of, you know, that we identified as like trying to show somebody that you love them. I'm not saying that you need to have, I mean, you know, I don't know fire departments well. I don't know if they think that we need 30 messages. But I think that the idea is that, especially the idea with this materials generator, is that we can give them a few, and then they can take those and run with them from there, and only operate within those few, if that makes sense.
Okay, may I add to that? Because I think it was confusing, even as we were working with Salter Mitchell, too, to get the terminology right. But I think the message, the one message, is have working smoke alarms. But that's not appealing and motivating. So what they came up with was two ways that did seem to motivate people, giving fire departments a choice. This one worked and that one worked. So it's not conflicting messages in or the way I see it. It's a better way to motivate people to have working smoke alarms. And it's how do you say that to them?
I also would think that part of the feedback that we had gotten from the fire departments was, part of it was about having you know, opportunity to use multiple messages. But the other part that I think that's the more important part is that they wanted to be able to localize it to their community to make it relevant, because they recognized that having sort of this broad thing wouldn't necessarily work for where they lived.
Zach, I think the fire service is a microcosm of society. And when we look at the research that we're doing in fire behavior and trying to deal with it tactically, even when we're talking about that, I think your message or the theme of your message is consistent, but you're going to need different deliverables to reach that audience that may have a cultural change to it or whatever. So I think it does have to have variance to it, but the theme can be one central theme.
Absolutely. And I mean, part of part of what we're doing with this materials generator, I'm less familiar with it at this point, but is creating those creating templates for different types of deliverables. Are we talking about door hangers? Are we talking about posters? Are we talking about large scale ads? Like what exactly is being creative? But within this generator, right, within this product, you're able to control the sort of branding and the messaging that are certain elements of it. And then you're able to cede some control to the local departments. So where they feel some buy-in, first of all, and then they're able to localize it the way they need to. So if they think, door hangers, won't work in this community, then they don't have to use them. You know, they have other sort of deliverables, other sort of collateral that they can use to reach who they need to.
Go ahead, please.
Mark. Okay. I wanted to go back to Wendy's comment about maybe one message is enough, but I liked what you had done with the presentation of having it broken down into installing a smoke alarm and maintaining a smoke alarm, because if you just say have a working smoke alarm, well, there's one up there. Mm-hmm. I put one up, I'm done. Mm-hmm. And I think that is the kind of thing I know I'm going to put in a plug for NFPA's Educational Messaging and Advisory Committee, but I think we forget what we know is not what everyone else knows, and we have to keep sharing that.
So one of the classic lines that we use at Salter Mitchell with every client that we have is that you are weird people. And that we need to recognize how weird we are and how we have an interest in our thing in a much different way than everybody else does.
A quick question here. I'm a big fan of Dan Ariely and predictably irrational. When we look at selling the benefits, we know it's not technically accurate to say a working smoke alarm can double your chance of surviving a fire, which is a more positive message, a home fire. But I'm curious, with available data and ways to manipulate that, is there any reasonable way to justify some message that says something along those lines where, working one in five or some statistic or equivalent to the population of Scottsdale, New Mexico, something along that message that this can really help provide that immediate benefit, be part of the few of the proud of the Marines who will have their lives saved this year by
working smoke alarm. Yeah, I mean, I think it all depends, right? Like, we tried some messaging like that in many ways. And the problem is that people already know that smoke alarms work, right? And so it's telling them that they work and telling them how great they are is not telling them anything new. It's not framing the issue in a different way to get them to think about it in a new way. It's telling them what they think they already know. And they go, yeah, I know, it works. I got it. It's up there. It doesn't work.
No, that's fair. One piece, and I'm not saying this for this much for the whole book, but one game changer, if you will, just internal to ATN group folks, was the recognition within kind of that realm of the industry that this is the most pressing threat to American life in terms of disaster threats, right, folks? Hurricane countries should prepare, and they do. You see high rates of preparedness in certain populations along the coast. But far and away, the most fatal threat to life from a disaster is home fires, which was new within the industry, and we saw a lot of
buzz and, oh, I didn't know that. And I'm not sure that that's a piece that can help change the information bit, but that's something at least within that sector of the community we saw resonated.
Go ahead, Phil, please.
Yeah, I wanted to go back to the old days before we had smoke alarms. And by 1976, almost no households had smoke alarms, and by 1981, over half the nation had smoke alarms. And the main way that message got out was from industry, not the fire service. Fire service was a supplement. Industry was putting terrific TV commercials on, and the fire service was saying, yeah, what they're saying is true. And I dare say we don't know how many people ever listened to messages from the fire service, let alone whether they sink in. We've been refining what the message is. I live in a county of about 800,000 population, a suburb of Washington, D.C. I have never had a message from my fire department on prevention. Never heard any. So I think that you know, that's one data gap of where are people getting information? Are they listening? And I'd like to ask the question to the industry people here. Are there plans to do major campaigns? Are you trying to sell more smoke alarms? They don't make much money on smoke alarms. You know? They're too cheap now. They've been a victim of their own success. But we haven't talked at all about getting industry messaging involved. I mean, the smoke alarm industry messaging involved, which gets the TV messages out there in prime time, not in 3 o'clock in the morning, meeting a PSA requirement.
And just to follow on to that, I think we would all agree the most successful single message that people know about smoke alarms did not come from anyone in this room. Change your clock, change your battery. If people know anything about smoke alarms, that's what they know.
The question becomes in human behavior, though, how many people might know it, but do they follow through? And I think that's where part of what we heard from Zach and from Phil and from Elise is that the emotional connection, the call to action, it doesn't connect. And I would just say, firefighters, we're just starting to get it about smoke ourselves, about how dangerous it is. We used to call ourselves smoke eaters. You know, I carried a cheater for years so that my air bottle would last longer so I could stay in fires longer. It made it look like I was breathing air and I wasn't. You know, it was a common practice. We all did it. You know, we laid in our bunks at night when I came on smoking cigarettes. You know, my mom points out that I used to poop my pants. I don't do that anymore either. So we're learning, but how do we get that message out to the public? I think in terms of human behavior, people have a very fearless, we were starting to get it with cigarette smoke, people hearing secondhand smoke, but a lot of those statistics are not being honestly relayed. I think that's a problem. But how do we relay how dangerous, besides the fact that it warns you of a fire, the smoke is? And I think we have someone, Mary Kay, and then the back.
So just a couple of things about Strategy 2 and the materials generator, and thank you, Zach, for that wonderful presentation. One of the things that we learned in our research from our audiences is that we all love our topic so much, we're telling the public too much, and they're glazing over, and we have our top 20 things we want everybody to know about smoke alarms. And so one of our big challenges, and it will not be universally popular, I'm sure, is when you go to the materials generator and you're choosing your messages, you won't be able to say 20. You will be able to say 1, 2, or 3, done. If there's another time you want to have a conversation, you'll have another opportunity, but you're not going to have this laundry list of stuff about smoke alarms, and that's by design. I think my thing with Salter Mitchell, that after 30 plus years of doing this was my big aha, was that issue of we're talking about these things because they're going to benefit somebody in the distant future if something unlikely ever happens to them. There's no reason to care about your smoke alarms if you think, oh, someday maybe I'm going to have a fire and maybe at that point it's going to do me some good. What they're saying to us is we've got to give our audiences a reason to care and do something right now. You're going to feel better protecting your family because of an action you're taking right now. And in terms of mass media, it's a whole different universe now from the days when we had one campaign and one public service, and now it's really niche stuff, and we have to figure out what behavior change are we looking for, what is it going to take with that segment, what are we going to have to do to prompt that change. It's really tough. So in the work we're doing here on this end, I know Johns Hopkins is doing this cool project partnering with Nurse Family Partners. I love, love, love this project. The firefighters are going into homes where there are nurses already present dealing with high-risk families, and that partnership is working. Materials Generator is going to give folks other tools. We're going to need a lot of them. But I think as we move forward here, what you're doing and evaluating that can be fed to us so we don't keep doing stuff that doesn't work is really going to be a trick. We've got to be much smarter about deploying our resources.
We're going to go to Deborah. Before Deborah goes, just so you know, V2020 is trending, so you talk about new media. Thanks to Common Voices and NFFF, which have huge followings and fast water, we're starting the trend. So V2020, take some pictures, get them on your Twitter accounts. And
hashtag.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I thought that was understood. That's almost like saying WWW. Deborah, you're up.
This is just to your question about advertising. And, you know, obviously it's a little different than the 80s when there were four or five channels. There's 1,000 channels now. And I know for a fact, just from me watching television as a consumer, Nest, First Alert, and Kidda all do advertising. Us, not so much in the television arena, but there are so many other facets of things that we do, and probably all the manufacturers, on a consistent level of public relations, social media, you know, cable versus network, radio, print. And you also have to imagine all the opportunities that come to us. They're very all difficult to say no to because we're all doing, it's all a form of a public service in some way. You know, it's not like we're, we don't make waffle irons. We make a life safety product. So it's hard to weed through all that. But I know for a fact that, you know, if you really look for it, it's all happening. And First Alert, because I work there and oversee it, does a tremendous amount of public relations. But we also spend a lot of money in terms of donating alarms, too, to the folks that need them, like we're talking about today. So I have other things to say, but I just wanted to answer that about of advertising. And I think what you're talking about more is a more of a public service campaign. You know, when we talked about the smoking campaigns and the helmet campaigns and the seatbelt campaigns, that's something different in terms of it's not advertising, but organizations have to get behind that to do public service.
We have one up front and then we'll go to the back.
Elise, you did a very nice job of summarizing the real world experience with smoke alarms. We did one of those studies, and I thought that perhaps our population was just highly unusual, because 45% of the smoke alarms that we put in were no longer there 10 years later. But Mark Jackson showed something similar from the SAFE program, about 30% or 37% were gone. And you said that in 6 months, 100 of your 1,400 smoke alarms were gone. And for some reason, people are actively doing something, but it's the wrong thing to do, of course. But I think this is an area that we need to find out more about, because that accounts for more of the lack of smoke alarms, more of the deterioration in smoke alarm coverage than any other aspect. Even then, I think more people were taking down our smoke alarms than were testing the ones that were up.
This probably already struck all of you already. I'm just a bit slow. But if you look at that rate over, if that was 10 years, the 10% or 100 alarms, if you project that over a full year, that's all the alarms are gone by 10 years' time. So at first blush, it seems awesome, right? Only 100 were taken down, but it's more troubling beneath the surface.
Eric, thank you. And then patience of Job back there.
Yeah, I'd like to follow up on the statement or the conversation about the increase in usage of smoke alarms in homes. And you know, that was really due in large part from the model codes mandating their installation. And this really all got started from a 1968 act signed by President Nixon to form a commission to assess the nation's fire problem and to identify ways to reduce fire loss. And that report was completed and presented to President Nixon in 1973. And this report, and I'm sure most of us know that, is America Burning. And in that, it had over 90 recommendations to reduce fire loss. And two of those recommendations related to smoke detection. And one of them, it recognized the need to promulgate regulations for the mandatory installation of smoke alarms. And then in 1976, NFPA 101 for the first time mandated their installation in newly constructed one and two family homes. So since then, we've seen a significant increase in the usage of smoke alarms in homes. And yeah, the manufacturers, First Alert, Kidde, those guys, they've probably done an excellent job in the 1980s in promoting their use. But really, I think with the housing boom in the 80s and the 90s and everything, a good part of that had to do with the model codes mandating their installation. So,
okay, we'll have Jim and then we'll come back over. Jim?
Well, a couple of questions. Richard Taylor's report back before there was money, and Richard was working for the Maine State Fire Marshal's office, and he and his boss agreed to take on a project of assimilating, you know, a research that had already been done. One of the issues that I got out of that was the utility, the relative utility of the smoke alarm itself. And so it's been described in other settings. Mary Kay, I think, I can't remember when you said it, but if my remote goes out on my TV, I get that fixed right away. If my smoke alarm goes out, who cares? I've got no day-to-day utility with that. So the first question is, does that show up anywhere in your human behavioral research in this, or is that a question still hanging? That wasn't rhetorical. I was hoping somebody would respond.
That's the smart outcome.
That's a, yeah, yeah.
I think it's a good point, Jim. I think that, you know, I can't say that it specifically came up when we were testing messages, you know, but I can say that the idea of not having an immediate reward, whereas your television remote going out and their immediate reward fixing that is that you can turn your TV back on. I think that combined with the fact that people sort of internalize and frame their smoke alarms in a negative way, you know, really is a big difference between, you know, how motivated they are to fix it.
Okay, then the last question is, I'll tee it up as Mary Kay did earlier. Then if we're thinking in terms of the gaps on the human behavioral research, I mean, pretty much some of the things are at least widely accepted, if not proven, people's attitudes about smoke alarms. I don't think a fire is going to happen to me. I don't think that I need a smoke alarm. And another one I think emerging, smoke alarm is a pain in the biscuits, and that is why I disable it, and then it's not going to happen to me, and you kind of go from there. But if you had to point out specific gaps relative to human behavior and attitude towards smoke alarms, what would those gaps be? That was also not rhetorical.
Well, I think Elise, if you wouldn't mind coming forward and talk about, Elise kind of mentioned that in her presentation when she said people were asked if they had them and they worked, and it turned out not to be true. So there was an ownership, but they wanted to claim ownership, but they really...
Yeah, and so I think... part of what we expected people to say was that, oh, well, that's what I thought I was supposed to say. So I said, yes, I have a working smoke alarm on every level. And we did see that to some extent. But a lot of people just don't, kind of what we were saying, that they're not sitting thinking about their smoke alarms all the time. And so when you really ask about, like, why wasn't your smoke alarm working, it's, you know, it's because they don't know. The people who were able to respond said, you know, the reasons that we expect is because it was beeping, and so, you know, I took out the battery because it was beeping. It went off when I was cooking, and, you know, I didn't want that to happen again. The information we don't have is kind of what Dr. Istre was referring to, which is why people take down those alarms. So our research looked at why their alarms were not working, but we didn't have the kind of the information to be able to ask, oh, well, we see we installed 3 alarms in your house, but I only have 2 here. Can you tell us a little bit about what you think might have happened to that third alarm? So.
Do you think they're taking them, throwing them away, or are they moving and taking them with them, or do we have any idea?
Well, we get the mics. We have the mics. Guys, we have the mics.
We found, we actually looked at that. We found that people who rent houses are more likely to have a smoke alarm that's missing. And people who were not the original residents when we put the smoke alarm in were more likely to have the smoke alarm missing. So in other words, the house had changed owners or renters or whatever.
Does that make you suspect they took it
with them? We didn't ask. We didn't ask where it went, but I think some probably took it with them. We don't know.
The other thing I'll state is in Baltimore, we actually screwed them into the walls. I don't know how, if you guys, you know, installed them with screws, or I know some fire departments use double-sided tape, but so I think we were a little surprised that, you know, that we've been putting them into the walls. So.
Yeah. We did that too. Mm-hmm.
Please go. Okay, so I just have very good presentation. I just have a couple of thoughts. First, talking about 3 behaviors. One is on the smoke alarm. Second is testing. And the third is maintain. It seems when you own, that is a simple behavior. You just need one time you own. But the testing and the maintaining that smoke alarm functioning require complicated. Like you have to do multiple times, you require more efforts. And there is strategy for the owning, because the mandatory installation codes, and also give away the free smoke alarm that make successful, the percentage of owning the smoke alarm is very high. But maintaining and testing is any strategy can actually enforce that behavior, not only from the improved individual behavior, but maybe some passive strategy like giving away or the code's requirement. So from different perspective, that is any thoughts from panel that can enforce that behavior?
Oh, Elise, any ideas? In other words, how can you get people to be motivated to maintain and to take care of their smoke detectors and test them?
I mean, I think in many ways it comes back to giving them an immediate reward, giving them something that they can, you know, feel or have after doing it right away. Because right now, the reward for testing your alarm, for maintaining it, is pretty remote for people. It doesn't resonate with them, you know, unless they have an experience with a fire, or have had an experience with fire in the past. It's just not out there. It's just too remote. I mean, I think that's a large part of it.
Well, aren't we eliminating a good chunk of the problem with the 10-year battery sealed alarms? Why do they have to be maintained?
Maybe.
Because they fail before 10 years?
They clearly don't last 10 years.
Well, I have some, you know, I could tie a little hypothetical back to some of the data and maybe a gap as to why some of those, even the 10-year alarms, were taken out of service. And the hypothetical I have is tied to nuisance alarms. The first time I have a nuisance alarm and I have to get out my ladder to push the hush button or silence it, I might go up, push the hush button, silence it, get down and walk away. The second time I have to do it, you know, I'm not stupid, I might get back up there and say, well, while I'm up here, why don't I just take it down? Because this won't happen again. And was there any way to tie the data from, you know, missing alarms to nuisances versus some other reason, or you just don't know?
Yeah, so for missing alarms, I don't have any data on that. The information I have is really about the non-working alarms. And with that, the two most common reasons were because the battery had been chirping or because it went off when it was cooking.
Back to nuisances, right.
Back to that.
We have a microphone. I wanted to make a comment real quick related to Ginger's thought about the different strategies for motivation, and it kind of builds on what Jim was saying. The utility of the smoke alarm, obviously to own it is one thing, we get it in the home, but then to make sure that it's maintained and that it's working. And if you'll suspend judgment for a second about the unintended consequence, but something like if you were able to have an alarm, and maybe this is actually maybe for later on or solutions, but what if you walk, every time you walked into your home and you needed to turn your light switch on, that's something that has to happen every single time that you walk into your home. What if you flip that light switch and the lights don't turn on and it's because your smoke alarm is not working and you've got to take care of that before your light switch gets turned on? That increases the utility of the alarm, and it is a motivator. Suspend the judgment on the unintended consequence. But it's like the remote control TV. I mean.
Thank you, TV remote.
They always have one, probably in every room.
Okay, couple of things, and similar to your point, I think in earlier discussions was somebody raised the idea that maybe the technology could come to make testing smoke alarms easier. Because right now, again, if you have to get on a ladder to test your smoke alarm, that's not something that's easy if it can be done with a remote or to hush it. If all of these things, if they were easier, I think that would help. I wanted to also mention something that was going back to ownership. And again, this was in Richard Taylor's paper, I believe, that he talked about how many different choices there are for consumers right now about what combination of sensors. Do you get ionization, photoelectric, both? Do you include carbon monoxide? Do you include 10-year battery, rechargeable battery, all of these things? It's like, I just want one simple choice. I don't want to have to make a decision out of a whole slew of different factors. And then I wanted actually to ask Phil a question. With the home visits, or any, this might be for Elise as well, are you also looking at just offering to do visits to just test alarms? Because it seems like we have a lot of inspection, a lot of installation programs. What is it, and you're trying, I know NFPA with Quincy had a program where they were offered for older adults, say we will come during October and test your smoke alarm, and if you need a new battery or need new or whatever, we'll get it in. And I was just wondering if that's covered in your home visit.
Yeah, and there are some cities that have taken that strategy, some in Canada, where they visit all homes, they test the alarms, and then they tell people what they need. The twist I like in Ontario is they visit, they test your alarm, and they either give you one alarm or no alarms, but they tell you how many you need, and they give you 2 weeks to install them to meet code. And if you don't meet code, they come back in 2 weeks and check. They give you a discount certificate to get cheap smoke alarms. And if you don't buy them, you get a fine. And the fine is of the order of the cost of the smoke alarms.
Interesting.
So they basically say, you know, it's part of your responsibility to have a smoke alarm.
Because we have never really enforced things with homeowners, even though the...
So those are departments where they're reluctant to... Where the fire department didn't want to spend the time to go in and install, it's a lot faster to just go run around, test, and say, here's what you need.
Just a quick question about chirping. One of the things I've been learning in a project I'm working on now in 5 communities, and also it came up with the nurse family partner, is that people hear the chirp and they misunderstand and they think it's telling them that their alarm is working. And so the whole misunderstanding of what the different sounds of the smoke alarm mean, I think also may deserve some further inquiry.
I just wanted to make the point about the reasons for taking them down, one being cooking. Drilling down into that question could either be a real nuisance that's facilitated by improper placement of the alarm, because it shouldn't be in or near the kitchen, But if it is in the proper location, it could be a success. It could be an appropriate alerting. So is there opportunity to reframe that as not a nuisance, but in fact a win that your alarm protected you?
Go ahead. You're the messenger.
I think that's a really interesting idea. I don't know if we ever really got into it in terms of the nuisance alarm itself. Mostly because it raises those other questions about like how close it is and whether it's properly installed. I think that it could be reframed. I think that it probably. I mean, like we're in general the. They need to be reframed from a nuisance anyway, right? In terms of like it going off because of cooking and it going off of in a way that they see as a nuisance, reframing that, you know, it seems very difficult to do, but it doesn't mean it's impossible. It's not something that we've looked into. But I do think it's an interesting idea, that specific instance of at this moment it's a nuisance, but maybe you shouldn't think of it that way. I think it would be a difficult thing to do, to reframe it in a way that says this is actually really positive for your home.
I just wanted to make a comment regarding the lithium technology. It's advanced quite a bit. You know, I remember years ago when the first 9-volt battery with lithium technology came out, and a lot of us, even my company, viewed that as extending the life of a smoke alarm for 10 years. But the shelf life of a battery doesn't necessarily mean it'll work for 10 years in an alarm. And so through those experiences, and I'll just give you a piece of information, if you compare that to the sealed-in 10-year lithium batteries, we've sold almost 40 million from 10 years ago. We track our rate of defectives, what didn't, you know, based on the information we get, which means it's just a partial where consumers took the time to call us and say, hey, this thing died before you promised it would, is 7 parts per million. And if you look at that compared to all of our other smoke alarms, it's by far better performance. So I think it's something worth looking at in markets that have 10-year sealed and relook at the data.
Please. Yeah, thanks, Bobby. I think a question for Zach and Elise. Just looking ahead at the behavioral gap that we may face shortly, is smoke alarms now need to have also an end-of-life signal. So like the chirp for the low battery, we need to be looking at how people respond when that alarm is telling them that it needs to be replaced, and maybe looking at how we could capture data on that without the intervention of having to go back in and actually replace it for them.
So I remember one time we were talking about looking at how can you tell the difference between your traditional battery and your long life lithium battery. And if you put them side by side, I think most people, including myself, can't tell them apart. And so knowing when do you need to, like, do I have that lithium battery alarm or is mine still the old technology? And kind of how can you tell those apart? I know that's not really the answer to your question, but that kind of end of life signal and being able to distinguish that from your general just change the battery signal or from an alarm signal. That's something that I think people are not going to be able to distinguish apart unless, you know, that's really clear in the smoke alarm packaging. So.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, I do think that you raise a really good point in that, someone mentioned earlier that the chirping is interpreted as it's working, right? People, unless it's very clear to them that, you know, that is, as the gentleman said back there, unless it says on the packaging, your lights are going to go off when this doesn't work anymore. I mean, it's an extreme example, but it is some of the outside of the box kind of thinking that maybe is needed. And when you think about how to differentiate between some of these different signals that the alarm is supposed to give you. I mean, one of the things I've always liked, I don't know the Nest product intimately, but you know, what I've seen in advertising is that it will tell you straight up, there's a fire here. That is a really clear message. You know, that's not, I don't need to hear that and interpret, the chirp. Well, does that mean it's working? Does it mean it's not working? Is there fire? Like, that's, it's pretty clear. So, I don't know. I mean, I think that, I think how well you're able to distinguish between what those signals are and how well you're able to communicate them to people in the packaging, in the messaging, the advertising around the product, that would be helpful.
Do you have time for maybe one or two more?
Sure.
Lorraine,
thanks. I take a couple of things away from this conversation. First, I think the things that we have been doing have worked to a degree between messaging, installation programs, and the like, and we need to keep doing that and do more of it. But we need to figure out how do we get through that delta of can we think of new things? And I go back to Paul's comment in the last segment about how do we make smoke alarms or fire safety cooler? You know, I wrote a column in Journal about a year ago when the Nest came out talking about the cool factor, saying, you know, can we get to a point where we're tied into smart technology in the home of the future, and how do we use technology better to benefit fire safety? So, and you know, and Zach just talked about that as well, is how do we think of new things, new ideas, you know, keep doing what we've been doing because we've had the success there, but we've got to figure out new ideas. You know, we just joked at the table and said, well, why don't we put the smoke alarm technology in the TVs because they've got one in every room and one on every level of the home. Well, you know, that might not be too far-fetched if we think about the interconnected home of the future and how do we make fire safety an integral part of that. So it kind of bleeds into our next session on technology, but it all runs together of what's the next generation smoke detection.
Time for one more over there, and then we'll...
Firefighters are very intuitive learners. And because most of their fire responses are fires in kitchens, when they become part of a home visit team to install smoke alarms, their automatic decision is that smoke alarm goes in the kitchen. So I'm a big proponent of training people before they install smoke alarms so that they're putting them in optimum locations to prevent nuisance alarms. Right now, our training for any smoke alarm installer and our project is 3 hours. It's very detailed, so they know what to do. Second of all, our high-risk population of older adults have trouble making technology work for them. And part of the equipment we install that shakes their bed and gives the low-frequency alarm has a digital clock on it that has to be set. And they don't know how to do that. So I know technology in the future is some answers, but right now, serving high-risk populations, sometimes they can't manage the technology.
Very last comment.
Okay, Nancy, you hit on my real hot button here, and that is it's important to install smoke alarms, but it's probably equally important where not to install them. And that's why, you know, my fear is with the fire service, the Red Cross, you know, we could have hundreds of thousands of these things being installed in homes, but if they're not installed correctly in the right location, then you're going to exacerbate the nuisance alarm problem, which will exacerbate the number of non-operational smoke alarms. And technology does play a factor in that. And it's not that one technology is inferior to the other. It's just the inherent way they detect the particles of combustion. So, I mean, as a rule of thumb, try not to install any smoke alarm really between 10 and 20 feet from a fixed cooking appliance, but if you do, it needs to be a photoelectric smoke alarm and not ionization.
Thank you very much. That, okay, last one. Just yell it out. You gotta be quick.
Yeah, I just had to say, we're talking about, can anyone hear me?
Gotta use the mic, because that's how it picks up on the recorder.
Okay. we're talking about behavior in households. Whatever state you're living in, depending on what state you're living in, 50, 60, 72% of Mainers own their homes. The rest rent. I can't help but wonder where this messaging is going, because I'm thinking what you're talking about primarily are homeowners who see the this responsibility of maintenance, installation, et cetera, is more being theirs, whereas I know renters in Maine certainly see that as the responsibility of the renter. Does any of this messaging go towards renters in any way, or?
It's come up for strategy to look at that as part of the two of generators.
Okay, so as Mary Kay just said, it's come up to look at that impact, you know, moving forward with the materials generator. I know that, you know, when we were doing some of the sort of formative research about the renters, there were questions in terms of like, well, I don't know whose responsibility this is. I don't know either way. But it is also just another sort of deflection in a sense. And I think that if you're able to still provide that kind of immediate reward, you know, that immediate sense of accomplishment, even if that is, you know, to say to them, you know, you get this reward for making sure you have a working smoke alarm, maybe their first step is to go to talk to their landlord, or maybe their first step, you know, I'm not sure. But, I mean, there is a very big difference between renting and owning and the responsibility you feel around that, for sure.
Well, I'd like to thank Elise and Phil and Zach for a great presentation. I'd like to do, two takeaways that I had was, one was that the language is so important, and there's a great book by a guy named Frank Luntz called Words That Work, and I think a lot of what we're talking about here and a lot of what's happened with the public in general is the words no longer have that much impact. Smoke detector, smoke alarm, smoke in of itself has kind of lost its fear, if you will. So maybe we need to look at our language and come up with more effective language. And also, for my smoke detector friends, and this might help you out, when I can't remember who was talking in the back, but they said it so eloquently, it was wonderful. You can't tell if your alarm is a 10-year-old alarm or a brand new alarm because they look the same. But if I go out in the parking lot, I drive a 2001 Pontiac Sunfire to work. It's a beater. And trust me, everybody knows a 15-year-old car versus, you know, a brand new Ford Fusion or something, you know, sporty and sexy like that. So every year they come out with new models of cars and they look different. So our reticular activator, our pattern matching, so that's new, that's better, it's gotta be, it's new, it's both. We're Americans, you know. I know in Phoenix, some people said they worked in Phoenix here, they used to throw away the fire trucks when the ashtrays got dirty. So, but new and sexy and it looks different, or it might be an idea to take back to your marketing folks. Maybe we need a new looking, sexier looking, yeah, new color scheme, yeah, something like that. Before we, I'd like to do something really quick. Jeff Richardson is here with us from Project Paradigm. I'd like him just to come up real quickly and talk real briefly about the resources that are available, the great work that he's doing. There's a flyer on the table, and if you wouldn't mind, Jeff, giving a few words.
Just briefly, our foundation is very much committed to fire prevention, and we're funding a number of organizations in this room on different aspects of that. One of the gaps I did want to talk about, and Phil raised this in his presentation, is concern of liability. And lots of organizations I speak with around the country as to why they're not doing home inspections or installations is liability. There's certainly union issues, there's certainly time issues, but liability comes up a lot. We're trying to tackle four issues, and just so you guys are aware of them, if you want to help out, if you have any thoughts or questions, let me know. First one is waivers. Some organizations use them. Some organizations, you know, if you're in Oregon, you go online, you find one because you don't have a lawyer. You download some form from Tennessee. Probably isn't even a law in Tennessee anymore when it was written. So first thing we're going to do is my law firm is going to prepare a waiver form for every state and update it annually and make it available for free. And that way you'll have sort of a best of breed waiver that you can use. We also provide some information with that as to what extent it's enforceable in certain states or for certain claims people have good information. Second thing we're looking at is sort of separating fact from fiction. I hear a lot of stories, oh, so-and-so was sued for that installation, or so-and-so was sued for that. When you track down those stories, most of the time they didn't happen. They're just rumors and fear. So we are going to go back as far as records will allow us, probably about 100 years or so, to look at what lawsuits have been filed. Certainly there have been cases against manufacturers, but that's not really what the installers are concerned about. It's if I put up an alarm and it doesn't work and there's a fire, am I liable for that? Or am I liable if I don't make it up the code, am I liable? So we're going to put out a one-pager separating fact from fiction, looking at what claims there have been against installers, successful, not successful. Two other things we're looking at, I don't know if they'll for sure work, but we're hopeful. One is creating a hotline in my office. We're a 105-year-old law firm. We stand behind our advice. I've got 125 lawyers, and so the idea is to have a couple lawyers in my firm be available to answer questions. I hear a lot of questions from city attorneys or somebody who says, hey, here's why we can't do it, or here's why we can't do it. And I think that if we can funnel all those questions in one place, I think my office can answer them efficiently. My foundation would certainly pay for the legal fees and services so no one has to be out of pocket. And you know, the first 15 or 20 times somebody gets a question, I have to go, hey, look it up in their state and call you back. But over and over and over and get the same questions, will be pretty efficient to provide that information. The last idea is actually the one I'm most excited about, and that is an insurance policy. I've talked to three or four different insurance companies about a possibility of Project Paradigm would buy an insurance policy, a liability policy. And then any organization that wants to do home visits could sign on to be additional insured. So you'd fill out a half-page form that says, here's my organization, here's how many I'm going to do this year, here's who I am. And for a very small amount of money, I think because the risk is so low, and I've given them some preliminary information about how low that risk is historically, I think they're going to underwrite that at virtually very little cost to me, certainly no cost to you. And that way organizations who are afraid of liability could say, hey, we have a liability policy of $1 million or $5 million or whatever it is. You know, we might have a small deductible, couple hundred bucks or something. So if you put your elbow through the drywall, okay, you guys can go take care of that. But if there's an injury or something or a fatality that you're concerned about, not only would we have the facts to separate fact from fiction and waivers, but if you knew ultimately you had liability coverage, I think a lot more people would go in and do inspections.
So as I mentioned this morning, we're obviously, as a School of Public Health, incredibly interested and invested in fire prevention and fire safety, as it is an important public health problem. And we're really blessed to be at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, where we have Dean Michael Clegg, who appreciates the importance of the injury problems and fire safety. And we're so delighted that he has some time to spend with us at lunch today. So thank you very much, Dean Clegg.
Thanks, Andrew. Thank you. So I do whatever Andrea tells me to do. That's why I'm here. And she knew the magic word. She said there's free lunch. So she knows me well. We are really proud of the Injury Center. And as you know, it's over 25 years old and just has an incredible track record of saving lives and preventing injuries. And Sue Baker, who may or may not be here, I don't know, but Sue is just a wonderful role model for all our faculty, because she did pioneering research and then taught us that doing research isn't enough. If you really want to change society and change lives, you have to take that research and get it off the shelf and advocate for its use. And so it's really wonderful to be here today and see people from so many sectors who are sharing, you know, research information, implementation, design, science, and policy. It's really, I'm really happy that you're here. I want to thank our center and under Andrea's leadership, and also Vision 2020 for making this event possible today. Vision 2020, as I've learned, is really an important partner for our Injury Center, and we strongly support your work to create and promote national strategies for fire loss prevention. And I'm a little embarrassed talking about injuries and deaths from fire to this audience, because it's really carrying coals to Newcastle. But it's a significant public health problem, especially here in Baltimore. Baltimore has thousands of house fires a year and too many deaths and injuries. And we just, for those of you from the area, we had a terrible tragedy in Annapolis, a high-income area, a new home, and, you know, tremendous loss of life of children and their grandparents. So we care deeply, as you do, about these issues, about death and injury from fire. I also want to thank FEMA for their leadership in supporting this work and in promoting fire prevention awareness and safety. Our school, to do public health, you have to be a collaborative person. None of us solve these big problems by ourselves. And our school's collaborated with fire service organizations throughout the country and has a long history of working with first responders, including firefighters, EMTs, and others, on research as well as in practice and in building systems at work. Our faculty in the center have developed interventions to keep firefighters healthy, so we work on the health promotion side with firefighters. As you know, it's hard to be a firefighter. And there's many things about being a firefighter that don't promote a healthy lifestyle. So we do that. We develop innovative educational programs for firefighters as well as for children and family. We really salute firefighters and the important work that they do every day to keep people safe, whether through prevention or rescue. It's essential to the well-being of our communities. With today's focus on smoke alarms, I was just here for a few minutes, but I already learned a lot. I'm going to go out and replace all my smoke alarms tonight. It's true. I mean, I didn't know that they had to be replaced, and so it's and I need some more advice before I leave about some smoke alarms. But when I was in the School of Medicine before I became dean, we worked at a clinic level to promote health, and one of the things that we worked on was for our patients, we would give out fire smoke detectors in the clinic to people who didn't have them. But I didn't know that that more than half the people who live in Baltimore City with smoke detectors who think they have a working smoke detector, in fact, half of them don't work. And this is a recent work done by the Injury Center. So this is a real problem for our city. We have old housing stock, and when we have a fire because of the row homes that we have, they often lead to multiple fatalities. We have a long history, and we're proud to partner with the Baltimore City Fire Department. And we partner with them on a number of things. Some of you may know that we have this this truck, trailer, the van that goes out and teaches people about injury prevention, not only fire and how to install smoke detectors, but a whole variety of things. And when I first became dean, and Andrea showed it to me, it's a beautiful big, triple axle truck. And I said, that's amazing. How do you maintain that? And she said, that's why we work with the fire department. They're really good at keeping. So we've been able to demonstrate that those programs are cost effective. So I'm sure that over the next rest of the afternoon, you're going to share lots of success stories. And I really hope that what we all learn from you and you learn from each other is going to result in many more successes in reducing fire deaths and injuries. So I want to thank you for coming. Thank you for participating. And know that we as a school are committed to reducing the number of fire deaths in the United States and increasing the number of homes that have working smoke alarms. So I'm very pleased to introduce our next speaker, who is an alum that we're very proud of. She's currently a supervisory program specialist at FEMA, and she received her MPH from our school in 2011. So please join me in welcoming Maggie Wilson.
Come back to Paul. I can do my own. Thanks, Maggie.
Thank you for that, and thanks to Vision 2020 for having me here today. I'm going to keep this quick because I didn't see dessert on a lot of people's plates, and so I know it's over there and people are itching to get over there. So I think the last time that I was in this room was my orientation to the MPH program, and I was completely awed and inspired by all the intelligence in the room, and I'm having those same feelings today. So thank you to everybody here for participating. I can't stress the importance of this summit. Not only all the information that's being shared and what's going to come out of this summit, but how it can help to inform the Assistance to Firefighters grant program. And I tell people this as often as they let me out of the office to speak, which isn't much these days, that the best part of the AFG program is that this program was designed by the fire service for the fire service. It's written into our law that we have to meet with the fire service every year, and we do so far more than that, to have them tell us what they need and what this program should look like. And that it's so important, and that's how we operate this entire program. Smoke alarms, as most of you know in this room, have been one of the highest priorities, at least since I've been at FEMA for 6 years now, but long before that. I think throughout the entire program, we've looked a couple times and pulled some data, we've funded over 2.5 million smoke alarms to be installed across the country. And that number is going up every year that we issue grant awards. One of the newer focuses that we have in AFG, and just started last year, is the focus that we have on national level projects, projects like Vision 2020, or the work that the foundation is doing. And that came from a recommendation by the fire service that with the limited funding that we have available under prevention, which myself and our branch chief Kathy Patterson always say it's the smallest program but the largest impact, we want to be able to develop programs at a national level that can have consistent messaging that can then trickle down to the fire service and to the communities implementing all those programs. So that's anything, like I said, from the smoke alarm work that we're doing to all of the firefighter health and safety work that Ron and his team are doing to the numerous projects that I've heard talked about here today that we've been so fortunate to provide funding for. So the last 2 points I want to make, the first is, one, I'm very excited to hear about all the different projects that have been named today that have been funded by AFG, the Attic Fire study by UL that we were able to fund, things like that. The number of successes that we hear about through this program is unbelievable, and I know there are a ton more out there that you guys are experiencing every day, and we want to hear about them. Whether it's a life saved, like Nancy Trench has, hopefully we'll be able to share later today about one they had 30 minutes after installers left the home, to taking research to practice and looking at one of the research grants that we funded, and 3 years later, a fire department receiving an AFG equipment grant to be able to implement the results of that research study, to coming up with new operational tactics for how we fight fire. We just sent, some of you might have heard, DHS had a potential lapse in appropriations recently, and one of the things that Secretary Johnson constantly talked about was the impact that that would have on the grants. We sent over a 6-page list of successes that we've received from you guys. So not only does it help that, it helps keep informing our appropriators how valuable these funds are. It helps us know all of the great work that's being done and inform the fire service so we can bring, when we meet with them every year, we can say, here's what this program's done. Here's some of the recommendations we're hearing about where the program needs to go. And finally, I would be remiss if I didn't say that we are in the middle of an application period for fire prevention. I just checked with Lillian in our office. We have about 700 applications that have been started at this point. Very few submitted, but that's normal. So you all have 17 days after you leave here to go finish your applications.
Don't we get extra credit for being here?
You definitely get extra credit, yes. No extra time. Yes, and Kathy also wanted me to pass on her hello and that she was sad she couldn't be here, but I think today she's in St. Kitts or St. Thomas, so I don't think she's too sad that she's not here. But two points about the application period. The funding cap is $1.5 million. One of the exciting things for those of you that haven't logged into your applications and started them yet is that this year, one of the things that we've been pushing for many years is that this year the fire prevention applications will have a period of performance of up to 2 years if you need it rather than one. And so we're very excited about that. So with that, thank you all, and I'll be around if anybody has questions at the end. Thanks.